Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to be here with you today and to see all your smiling faces. Welcome to Ebenezer Methodist Church. Special welcome to anybody visiting with us today. We would ask that you would fill out the visitor cards in the back of the pews. If there's anyone looking for a church that's free from worldly things, free from conflicts, free from politics, and free from the baggage of the world, a church filled with love, with friends, and with family, if you're looking for that, you've found the right place. So we're definitely blessed by God. And let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for all you have done and for your new covenant, for your immaculate plan, and for the mighty acts of Jesus Christ, your perfect, unblemished Son, who paid the price for all our sins, past, present, and future. And it's for freedom's sake that we were set free. So today, as we worship him, grace us with your presence. May your Spirit open our hearts so we can feel your love. And let your Spirit open our minds so we can comprehend and know your word. And let your Spirit shine your light to guide us on the path that leads us to you and a much deeper, more personal, intimate relationship. We ask this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, our scripture reading this morning comes from Psalm 16. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad and my tongues rejoice. My body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful ones see decay. You make known to me the path of life, and you will fill me with the joy of your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. This is the word of God for the people of God. Okay. Our hymn of praise this morning is found on page 545. The church is one foundation. Let's rise and sing it together.
Oh,
standing, and we will sing our greeting chorus. Blessed be the tie that bind. It's in your bulletin and on page 557.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that love.
All right, let's greet each other with Christian love. Y'all did well. Let's go ahead and recite our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, on page 881.
Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
Okay, for our announcements, the birthdays and anniversaries this week is Dimitri on the 26th, Helena on the 1st, and Susan McGuire the 2nd, and James and Meredith Tongue's anniversary is on the 30th. So happy anniversary and birthday to all those folks. The Bible study order this week, we're going to be in chapters 9 through 13 in Hebrews. It's an amazing book. So please plan on doing reading this week. Penny Evans will be handling she'll be the point person. If we have any questions, you can just email them to the office at ebsumc.org. And today, after the service, we'll be having a potluck fellowship meal, so please plan on staying and eating. Let's see, for outreach. All right, our outreach is going to be the sandwich project, and so if you have the ability to make a sandwich or you'd like to come and provide some of the things necessary to make a sandwich, I believe it's going to be on Tuesday. Yes, Tuesday at 10 a.m. Plan on being here. And does that go all the way to 6 p.m.? Or is that 10 a.m. and?
10 and 6.
10 and 6.
And we have a lot of leftover stuff, so if y'all haven't got anything you just want to bring, just come on anyway. We'll probably have to get by with it.
And how many sandwiches did you make last week?
More than 400.
More than 400.
Wow. Within the span of total an hour and a half, probably between the two.
They were only hoping for 100.
Wow.
So, as Ebenezer is, we had to give more.
Just abundance. Our Lord is abundant. Amen to that.
Amen.
Yes. Also, at 6:30 Monday evening, there will be a council meeting. Please plan on attending that. And one other, next Saturday, July 2nd, will be our men's breakfast. Do we have any other announcements? Okay, great. Thank you.
All right, it's great to see everybody here today. We do have a number of prayer concerns. I would ask you to read over all the names in the bulletin. If you have a specific prayer concern, please write it down on one of the cards in the pew and put it in the offering plate. Deb Powles will be facing surgery on Tuesday. She actually had a stroke last week. She's at Northside Cherokee. She's doing well. She's able to speak more clearly now, but that was a little bit of a shock to her. So keep Deb in your prayers. Linda Bell's sister Laura is having some advanced symptoms from COVID, and she went to the ER, and she's staying over at Northside Cherokee as well. There's some respiratory issues. We've got a few members that have tested positive. Fortunately, it seems like all the symptoms have been very mild, and people seem to be getting over quickly. But just let us know if you or anybody else knows that tested positive, just so we can sort of keep track. It does seem like this is becoming much more like a cold or even a light flu, but we don't want to take anything for granted, and we just want to make sure that we keep our folks informed. Rachel Reynolds continues to recover. She's having a hard time getting around, so she's sort of stuck at home, and I know she misses being with her church family, so keep Rachel your prayers. And I just want to give thanks to Cary and to Penny for our youth group trip this last week, and also for Little River UMC that loaned us their bus, which was really a great blessing. And grateful to the parents and grandparents for those who allowed us the privilege of taking their children down there. It's a blessed, sacred place, and it was a wonderful time. First time I went down there was 1989. It was the best weather I've ever seen in St. Simons. First time I went down there, don't remember getting eaten alive by gnats. It was phenomenal. I know it was much hotter here, more humid here than it was there. So everything was extraordinary. So, and thank the church that Ebenezer has been generous. We pay for everything. When I say everything, I mean, bike rentals and going out for ice cream. And, we purchased a couple of beach toys. And as long as we can do that, we'll do it. I know that the Lord continues to be good. And you know what? As far as I know, you may know better, you can't outgive God.
Amen.
So we're just thankful for the generosity and for our outreach, what's going on with the meals and all those things. And also, in being mindful of that, As we gather tomorrow morning at prayer for 9 a.m., we are fasting as a church on Monday. If you haven't joined us yet, please do. Whether you're going to skip a meal, three meals, whether you're just going to do without a chocolate bar for the day, that's up to you. But I would encourage you, for our days of prayer and fasting, turn off the television. Ignore social media. Separate yourself from the noise and take some quiet time. That's what fasting is. It means we're giving up this, I'm giving up eating and doing those things. And in that time, I would normally be eating. Now I'm going to focus on prayer. And one of the most important parts of prayer is the listening. So as a church that we're praying, we're fasting over, we want to see revival. I don't know if y'all noticed, our nation seems to be going a little nuts. Have you noticed that? It is. And the anger and the division may have a place in the nation. It doesn't have a place in the church. So we want to be prayerful, pray for revival. We want to pray for the lost. We leave the 99, chase the one. And I know we share prayer concerns, and most often it has to do with a medical issue or some crisis. And those are all serious and important. We want to pray for those. Those are not as important as praying for the lost, because that's eternal. And so I would encourage you then to think of those people in your lives, whether they're family members or friends or neighbors, that do not know the Lord. And so that's another reason we're in prayer and fasting, and for discernment of our church, that we desire and remain in the center of God's will. And so for those things and for our nation, I would encourage you to participate in that. And then, if you're faithful in prayer and fasting, and while you've separated yourself from all that noise, you hear the Holy Spirit whisper to you, tell us about it. That's the great joy, that we get to share and hear what the Lord is doing in our lives. It was kind of fun with the youth. We you know, took their phones and, for the most part, occasionally gave them back, and it really wasn't much of a battle. What was interesting, after I think they went probably a little more than a day without their phones at all, and then before lunch I said, we all can have your phones back before we go to lunch. Like, that's okay. But we'll wait till we get back from the beach. And I think they were sort of getting used to, you know, just sort of separating, which is not a bad idea for adults either. So for all those things, we're just grateful. And anybody else have something else they want to share? Any prayer concerns or Thanksgiving that you want to lift up? Yes, Chrissy.
Pray for Ruthie. He got stung multiple times last evening. Yellow jackets or bees, I think, disturbed the nest, I think, and he's swollen and hurting. And pray for his recovery. And the good news is my dad has been back in his apartment for the longest stretch, probably 5 months, as opposed to being in the ER or the hospital. So that's very good news.
Very good news. Awesome. Thank you. Yes, Francis.
I spoke with Christine, or I messaged with Christine, and her mom's going to have to continue her battle with her bladder cancer. They died out, so just an extra prayer for her. Her mom's name's Marilyn.
I just want to mention the little girl that had the eye socket issue that I had been requesting prayer for. I talked to her dad yesterday. She's healing great from that, but in that particular eye now, she's having double vision. Because they said that when they had to cut the muscle to drop the eye out, now that it's developed scar tissue, so they're not really sure what they're going to do. They're getting ready to do a bunch of testing. But just keep, her name's Rachel, please keep her in your prayers.
Okay. Denise?
There's a couple of, I knew the mom from growing up in the church with her. She and her cousin lost a child.
Clay and Jody Smith.
Yes. Prayers for Joe on Friday. He's having a tendon reattached to his shoulder, having surgery.
All right. Prayers for Joe. Okay. You said that's on Friday?
Friday at Northside.
All right.
Okay. I just want to say I'm happy to be back.
Yeah, amen.
Happy that you're back.
Yeah, don't leave anymore.
I don't want to anymore. Sure.
All right. What do you say?
Just to remember Connie Curtis and her mom, Joyce Wall, and the death of her brother, Jeffrey Wall.
Yeah. Yeah, Connie's brother has passed away. They had the service yesterday. Just pray for her. Well, it's great to see everybody here today. Wonderful to hear the laughter in Sunday school class. Not always appropriate during a sermon. Maybe it is. Let's have a moment of quiet meditation. Let's prepare our hearts for prayer. Lord, we give you thanks that we have this place to gather on the sacred ground that has been provided for us. And Lord, our gratitude for the great cloud of witnesses that has come before us. And it's our desire that we would be found as faithful stewards as well as all that we have been given. Lord, we just want to lift up all these concerns, every name listed in our bulletin, the concerns that we have raised up this morning, and for the unspoken concerns that each and every one of us has as well. Lord, we give you thanks for the miracles and the healing we've experienced, but it's our desire to leave all these concerns at the foot of your throne and ask you to intercede on behalf of our loved ones. Lord, whether it's a recent loss of life, whether it's an upcoming operation or medical procedure, or those, Lord, dealing with other illness, in addition to healing, we just pray that your presence would be known, that as a group our faith would increase, as a nation that we would come back together and learn to listen a little better in all things, that we would seek to understand before trying to be understood. Lord, we just want to lift up all the churches, all the congregations that surround us throughout this community. Every place where the gospel is proclaimed, Lord, we pray for those congregations that you would bless them and give them growth. We pray for the leadership, that would be godly leadership, and that you would lead us all from temptation. That you would help us, Lord, to keep our eyes fixed firmly on Jesus, that we would never forget our first love. And all things begin with loving God. Father, we just thank you for our teachers, for our leaders of youth, for all those who love you so much that they're so willing to give of themselves their time and resources. And that in all things, Lord, that we might remain as a faithful body of believers, like-minded, and giving thanks that we can gather here and pray together in the words that our Savior taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please receive these tithes and offerings as tokens of our love for this church and for its ministries. May they go forth from this place just to find the rightful thing. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you.
there in preparation is Be Thou My Vision on page 451.
Say, I'll make a reference to, you know, somebody who may have been in church or maybe in study and sort of, you know, in that kind of middle ground where they're not connecting the dots, and all of a sudden something happens and I say the light has gone on. Sometimes you can almost see a physical change in somebody's countenance when the light has gone on. As a pastor, there's few things that have given me more joy, and I mean few, than somebody who might be in their seventh, eighth, even ninth decade of life when the light has gone on. And all of a sudden, there's an excitement and a passion for the Word of God that has never existed. The light doesn't go on just by sitting in church. In the 8th chapter of Luke, and the start of this chapter is that Jesus is talking about the parable of the sower and the seeds. What he says is, as the seed is going everywhere, and the seed is the Word of God, and it goes everywhere, and it's fallen on a hard path and rocky soil and a soil with weeds and fertile soil, the word doesn't change. The difference is how receptive the soil is. We can look around the room and we don't have a sign on us that I'm rocky soil or I'm a hard path. But it's an individual thing, the condition of the heart to receive the Word of God. And when you become fertile soil, when all of a sudden it's illuminated to you and it makes sense, that's when we then bear fruit. That's when we have this blessing of being filled with the fruit of the Spirit and the joy. And that's where our scripture picks up in Luke 8 in verse 16. And as a result of this parable of the sower and the seed, Jesus then says, "No one lights a lamp and hides it in a jar or puts it under a bed. Instead, he puts it on a stand so that those who come in can see the light. For there is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed, and nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the open. Therefore, consider carefully how you listen. Whoever has will be given more. Whoever does not have even what he thinks he has will be taken from him. Lord, may the words of my mouth and meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. Amen." All right, so when Jesus begins this, is that it's common sense. Anybody who has a light, you light a lamp, you don't then cover it up. If you walk into somebody's house and it was dark and you said, "Why don't you turn a light on?" They said, "Oh yeah, I did. I turned a lamp on and I stuck it under the bed and put a blanket over it." You light a lamp for a reason, to illuminate your home. And so when Jesus, in the parable before the sower and the seeds, he was talking about those that have received this word, and now all of a sudden they are fruitful and they become this light that needs to be put on a stand to illuminate and to share what's been learned. And then, now by the way, I've often made the comment that if you're not uncomfortable with what you've read in the Bible, you're not reading enough. And so when I come across verse 17, for there is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed, nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the open. Therefore, consider carefully how you listen. And listening has to do with how receptive the soil is, how carefully we listen. And so, if indeed we're receptive, and yet we can't discern everything, which we can. Does anybody here understand all the Bible? I sure don't. But Jesus promises the day will come when all these things will be disclosed. So don't be discouraged. Don't give up. That's what happens oftentimes. We see things in the Old Testament that make sense to us, or we can't connect some of the dots, and then we want to give up. No, because he who has will be given more. So when folks say, well, I don't really understand the Bible, it doesn't make sense, and my comment would be, if you're faithful to what you do understand, more will be given to you. You'll understand more. But that means being careful about how we listen, and also then being receptive, because at some point here, it's all going to be revealed. It's all going to be explained. Later on in Luke, on Resurrection Sunday, as Cleopas and his buddy are leaving, or they're going off to Emmaus, and then Jesus appears. They don't know it's him. And Jesus is like, hey, so what are y'all talking about? He goes, well, don't you know what's happened? And Jerusalem goes, no, what's happened? Well, it was about Jesus of Nazareth. We thought he was the man. We thought he was going to be the Christ. And yet, he was betrayed and put on trial, and they crucified him. So our hopes are dashed, and they're hanging their heads, and they're walking off. And Jesus said, how slow of heart, not lacking in faith. And then he explained. He explained all the prophets, how this was going to happen to the Christ. Now, he didn't have a New Testament. He was prophesying about himself and what was going to happen. And they had to be receptive to hear that because they did not understand. He who has will be given more. Be careful how you listen and be patient and don't give up. More will be revealed. Matter of fact, this is a common theme in Scripture, by the way, about nothing being hidden. In Luke, just later on, chapter 12, verses 2 and 3. And if this doesn't bother you, let me read it slowly so you can take this to heart. There is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What you have said in the dark will be heard in the daylight. And what you have whispered in the ear, in the inner rooms, will be proclaimed from the rooftops. Yikes. So think about it. What you have whispered, or what you have quietly, will be shouted from the rooftop. This is one of the reasons I can't stand political correctness. It is such a horror. It's so, you know why? Because it has nothing to do with transforming the heart. All political correctness is, you better be quiet and not use that word, that term, or say this, because you get. My attitude is, I want to know what you're thinking. If you have a prejudice or a sexism, I want to know about it. I don't want to be trained. Oh yeah, you can harbor that malice in your heart. You're just not allowed to say it. And that's what we do. We like to deal with the symptoms rather than what the root cause is, because everything that's buried will be exposed. Now here's the good news. Well, that's kind of frightening about what is whispered in the inner rooms. And by the way, this is a lesson for us. We need to help our friends who gossip, because when they whisper and say things, please stop them. If they don't know any better, remind them, because I don't want them shocked. Because when Jesus says this, you know what? This is going to happen. There's no debate about it. Things that are hidden in darkness will be exposed to light. And so when people get in this bad habit of complaining, say, you don't want to do that. Don't go there. Remind them. So then they can be transformed, their hearts from the inside out, and be light. So we want to guard our hearts from those things and not deal with just the symptoms, But the root cause of those things, which is a lack of light, a lack of love, and be receptive. So the question, the challenge is, Jesus says, to listen carefully. Okay, I want you to listen carefully, what I'm going to say, okay? You're the manager of a restaurant, and there's 42 people there, 42 people. And then a table of four leaves, and then six more people come in. Then a table of two leaves, and eight more people come into the restaurant. Okay, you got that? Who is the manager of the restaurant? You are. You are. Do we listen carefully? You know, because we miss things that matter. And ultimately, it's like understanding how the Lord works and joining him in that and being light. When you have light, you don't hide it. You don't bury it. You put her up where it can shine in the darkness with patience and perseverance. My close friend is, he does, you know, like extreme sports and trains, and he's got a training partner. And for years they've been, they go on 20-mile bike rides, and I'm sorry, they go on 20-mile runs, and when they're done with the 20-mile run, they go on a 100-mile bike ride. It was part of their training. Well, when you're riding a bike for 100 miles and then running 20 the other way around, you have a lot of time together. So my dear friend who just loves the Lord and also loves his friend who's a non-believer. His friend's a physician, and as he said, my buddy says, this may be the smartest person I know. And so while they were going on these long bike rides and runs, he would talk about Jesus, talk about his faith, and share with his friend, because my buddy is a light in the world, and he loves his friend. And his friend was always very respectful, and just wouldn't believe, a man of science, and he couldn't accept, you know, this teaching about Christianity and faith. This went on for years. For years. And all this time, and once again, just respectful and listening, but just not receiving. Well, one day, my friend gave his training partner a book called, For Answering Questions for Skeptics. It was basically a book written from a father to his son about those who were skeptical about faith. And the doctor took it and did what we do, what most books we don't want to read, just stuck it in a drawer somewhere where it sat for years. Then the doctor was struggling in his marriage and having a falling out with his spouse, and got to a point where he left the home and got his own apartment, sort things out, and you know, in this midlife crisis, leaving his family and his wife, and now sitting alone in his apartment, and on his nightstand there was that book. That I had no idea how that book got there. Said I remember picking. I don't even remember where I got it, but the book was there. And he started to read it. And when he read it, all of a sudden those dots began to connect, and the light went on. And then he called his training partner, my close friend, and said, you know, you've been witnessing me for all these years. It never made sense. He said, I understand now. He said, and Jesus is my Lord and Savior. The light went on. But that was the beginning of the journey, not the end. And so now he's a passionate student of Scripture and passionate to be light to others and share with them. Because that's what happens when we receive the light. And Jesus says, then you are the light of the world. We don't hide that light. We don't get timid because the world's angry at us or doesn't like us or disagrees. And it's like, no, the reason is because the world is in darkness and it's evil. And John 3:17 says, here's the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men prefer darkness than light because their deeds were evil. I'm here to remind you, in the words of Jesus, there's nothing hidden that will not be exposed. So the bad news is, the frightening thing is, all that stuff I whispered, maybe I didn't intend somebody else to hear, be exposed. Here's the good news. I can whisper lots of stuff. I can whisper, Jesus is Lord. And to be proclaimed. Matter of fact, what Jesus says, don't let your left hand know what your right hand's doing. When you give, just give it quietly, because your Father knows and sees all. He says, when you pray, go into a closet, shut the door, and pray. And so at some point, you know what's going to be revealed? All the people praying for you. All the people that did pray for you. And wouldn't it be wonderful if the people sitting next to you, you found out later, somebody maybe you never sat with at lunch, never got a cup of coffee with, what if you found out they had been praying faithfully for you? all these things will be disclosed. And it's our choice then is to what that we use with our gifts and abilities and talents then to be light into this world. So as we go through this process, we're having a meeting tomorrow night of the council, and coming up to this point where that we disaffiliated, you know, we had to have some conversation. There's some things going on that we weren't able to be open and public about because some things were sensitive. We're kind of concerned whether we did everything the right way, and a bunch of us were uncomfortable about it. It's because we don't like to have meetings and do things that are not public. Well, here's the beauty. Now that we've gone through this process, our goal moving forward, we've talked about as a church, how we our beliefs and our governance, it all has to be wide open. So understand this, as we talk about our process here on now, every meeting, everything we do will be wide open, with the exception of, you know, like SPR, the staff parish relations, that talks about the personnel. Some of those things have to be private. So if they're discussing, you know, how they're going to get rid of the inefficient pastor, those things have to be in private. Now, you do get to show up at the meeting and weigh in and say, please get rid of the pastor, but then you must believe when they discuss it. But other than that, we are not going to hold meetings that are not wide open. Now, you may not get to vote on all those, maybe committees, but I sure hope we don't have many votes. I hope it's consensus. If we have a vote that's 5-5 or 5-4, we've done something wrong. But it all needs to be like this. So the beauty is my question, how transparent can we be? If y'all got any ideas, we'll do everything we can to be accountable. That's a big, huge issue in our government and our church. We've gotten to a mess from a lack of openness and transparency, and I've been having conversations, and it's so unpleasant and unkind words. First of all, we shouldn't be talking unkindly about non-believers. I got people who have given their lives devoted to the Lord, now name-calling others in the body of Christ? That's shameful. And so we're gonna reap the consequences of that. And so for us, the question is how open, transparent, and accountable we can be. And I almost think you can't be too open, because guess what? There's nothing hidden that won't be revealed. So if it's gonna be shouted from the rooftops, I'm wasting my time trying to keep secrets. And also what that means is the Lord's not gonna bless it. So I'm excited, because what we're planning and what we want to do towards governance, it's all about who's coming after us. It's all what we hand off, because you know, in the hearts of men, when we do things in secret, is then we have a tendency to want to keep those in secret. Everybody likes secret information. In the stock market, we call that insider trading. It's illegal in most cases. I think in Congress it's illegal, because they set their own rules. That's different. But you know what I'm saying? Is that, you know, we don't want to take advantage of things in private that need to be public. So as we look at this, I'm excited. I think for the pastor of the church, in addition to whether it's salary or benefits or all those things, I think it'd be reasonable if the pastor of the church, every so often, quarterly or annually, has a detail, all expenses, how many meals or mileage, I mean, what's there to hide? And if we feel like we have to hide something, then probably no good's going to come of that. So what are we giving the next generation? How we handle ourselves in our finances, in our giving, in our service to one another? Because light is good. Light from the Word of God illuminates. And here's the good news now. Well, I can whisper Jesus is Lord, and then I can pray for people that don't know I'm praying for them that we'll find out later. All these things we do in secret. But the other thing is that Jesus promises, John 8:31 and 32, to the Jews who believed in him, what he said is that if you're truly my disciples, okay, so from false disciples, people just hanging out and hanging around and not really good, if you're truly my disciples, then you will know the truth, and the truth will do what? To set you free. You know what that means? It means if you're not free, if you're somehow feeling in bondage, if your heart is heavy, then there's error in your thinking. There's error in your theology. It means you need to be corrected. because truth sets us free. That's the promise. The word of God, what does it say in Psalms 119, verse 105? Psalm 119 is really long. Verse 105, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. A lamp unto my feet that it illuminates. That's what we want. Nothing good happens in darkness. The only thing that happens in darkness is mold and mildew. Light cleanses. So it doesn't mean that things get held up and illuminated. It doesn't mean that we might not be embarrassed. We will, but you know what? Then you apologize. You mess something up, something you shouldn't have done, you apologize, say, I'm not going to do that again, and you bring it into light that's cleansing. That's what we want to do in everything we can, and so then be grounded in the Word of God, because just as it can be confusing and difficult, Lord promises, hang in there. There's nothing now that's confusing, nothing that you do not understand. Like on the road to Emmaus, it's all going to be explained, and it's going to be glorious. So don't worry about the stuff you don't understand. The older I get, the more comfortable I've gotten in my ignorance, which is a good thing. But also, it makes me want to be receptive to what the Lord's going to teach me. And that's the challenge. Because a lot of times people throughout history have gone in Scripture to justify what they already want to believe and make comfort. You won't find truth that way. People have done that in justifying racism or slavery, justifying hatred of Jews and make themselves more comfortable. You know, that's just not bringing it to the light. And so be able to receive Scripture. We can all agree what it says, and the question is what it means. Some of it's very clear. And when the words of Jesus says that those things whispered in the ear in the inner room will be shouted, you know what? You can count on it. So you can't blame me on that day when it happens. You can be, man, I'd have thought a whole lot more about what I was whispering. I should have known about it. You do know about it. And I want you, as light of the world, to remind your family members, your friends. You don't want to say that. I would often tell my children, you never have to apologize for something you didn't say. On the other hand, that we're to be sharing the gospel as ambassadors of the good news, looking for every opportunity. If we're light in the world, to let that light shine, the darkness cannot withstand it. And so the enemies may scream, they may yell, turn that thing down. We want to hear, is it? We know through the power of the Holy Spirit that that light transforms, and then we see somebody who for years and years, hard-headed, non-believer, all of a sudden that light goes on, and now they're a committed believer. Now they've gone from, and by the way, that's the beauty of the gospel, the beauty of the Holy Spirit can change the condition of the soil. You can go from being a hard path to fertile soil. That has to do with the power of the Holy Spirit and our willingness then. Be sure to listen carefully. So what that means is when you're going through Leviticus, like we were, you're like, yikes, when are we done with this? You're going through Deuteronomy. And your prayer is, Lord, I don't understand. What can I learn here? What can you show me through this? What is it, Lord, I need to know? Whatever it is. When you're sitting through a sermon, thinking, I've heard this before. This is boring. Just pray, Lord, what can I learn through this? What can your Holy Spirit reveal to me? And our God who is faithful says, he who has will be given more. And he who doesn't have, even the little they have, will be taken away. So how receptive are we going to be? And how committed are we going to being transparent and open and honest? How committed are we going to be to pray and fast? Because here's the reason we pray and fast. We listen better. That's the idea. And so as we're going through our Mondays, full days of fasting, said, whatever you decide to give up, just turn the TV off, turn the radio off, and just as you're praying over these things, praying for revival and praying for the lost and praying for the churches around us and for our discernment as a church, for our opportunity to be salt and light, as you're praying for those things, listen. That may be the most important part of prayer. Sometimes the Lord answers my prayer that I want. Sometimes he doesn't and ends up changing my heart through that. This is why I want you to fast along with us. I want to hear what you've heard from the Lord. I want you to share. I want somebody to say, you know, the Lord put on my heart a new outreach opportunity, a mission project. I feel called to you know, do A, B, and C. That's the blessing. We each have a different part in this work. We all have a light that we're to carry. We all have a piece of that gospel to share. And the blessing is when we share with one another, it's an encouragement to one another. The choice is ours. Somebody sitting next to you, whatever the condition, the soil, I don't know, where are you on your walk, how many years you've been in church, how long you've been studying the Bible, how much you have figured out, whether you have any questions, but my prayer would be that wherever you are, you would listen carefully, that you would be receptive to the teaching of the Holy Spirit, and that you would hear from God, and it would be clear, and then you would stand up in church one day, one morning, and tell us about it. Let us pray. Lord, it's our desire to humble ourselves before you. It's our desire, Lord, that we would listen carefully, that we would receive more of your cleansing, powerful, freeing word. Lord, not that we would keep it to ourselves, but that we would be a light within this community, that we would celebrate transformation together, that we would not grow weary of doing what is good, but celebrate when you have reached into the heart of another and transformed it from the inside out, that we would all celebrate the good news of the gospel together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The hymn of invitation this morning is There's Within My Heart a Melody on page 380. Let's rise and sing it together.
Now receive the benediction. Go forth from this place, hopefully the lunch, go forth from this place with hearts full of assurance that the good work, the transforming work the Holy Spirit has begun in you, he will continue until that day when our Lord, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, returns in glory and power. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Let's eat. All righty. All right. All right, y'all have a great... Oh, y'all can... Oh.